Dear friends, welcome to this edition of Journal Club. Today, we are going to discuss a very interesting discovery, I would say. Discovery is the word because there seems to be a new interest in a set of acini noticed in the nasopharyngeal region, and the paper that's being published brings this to highlight, and it's possible that this could even be an important salivary gland. Let's see what this is about. I am Dr. Balasubramanian. I work here as a professor in the anatomy department, St. John's Medical College. Now, the title of today's journal club is like this. It's a very recent publication. I think I must have seen it about a week back maximum. It's coming up in the Radiotherapy and Oncology Journal from the Elsevier Publications. It's entitled The Tuberial Salivary Gland, a Potential New Organ at Risk for Radiotherapy. That's interesting. This is a joint paper by Walster et al. From Netherlands. They are the members of Head and Neck Oncology and Surgery team. There are others from other parts of Netherlands also in this. It looks like a very interesting paper. I thought as anatomist, we may have some interesting points to catch up on this. You see, before we start this discussion, I have been firmly of the view that anatomy never changes, but our concepts and our understanding of anatomy keeps changing. In recent 2-3 decades, a lot of new things have come. Otherwise, Gray's Anatomy won't have reached its 42nd edition. That means there is growth in knowledge, there is progression of research. Well, hitherto rigid concepts are now being reinvestigated. There is news coming up that there may be new organ systems. Something a few years back we heard about mesentery, we heard about the vasculature in the dermis of skin. All these are new things. The connective tissue of the mesentery. Some very interesting issues have come up. Why? Even the age-old belief that there are no lymphatics in the brain is now being challenged, and there are good papers with very good confirmation based on very objective research methodologies that there is lymphatics inside the brain also. Well, we have also accepted that there indeed is a colosigmoid valve at the junction of the descending colon and the sigmoid colon. That means it's not that new structures are coming up. New understandings are coming up on structures which we had hitherto maybe, sidelined or ignored as a routine pattern. Maybe something else is coming up. Let's have a look at this very interesting salivary gland, the possibility that there is another salivary gland, tuberial salivary gland. Let's have a look at this. The authors, I'm just analyzing the opinions given by the authors. What they are trying to say is, the presence of previously unnoticed bilateral macroscopic, you see, visible to the naked eye, salivary gland locations in the human nasopharynx was suspected after visualization by positron emission tomography and CT with, that particular prostate specific membrane antigen ligands. Now, this is the first time, we are beginning to appreciate some molecular techniques combined with imaging, and certain new observations and new discoveries are probably coming up. That's the first point to note in this slide. Well, patients with tumors in this region, nasopharyngeal tumors, have some problems like this. Affected patients will experience difficulty in food intake, swallowing difficulty, digestion, speech problems, increased risk of caries, oral infections, with significant impact on their quality of life. The major salivary glands in the vicinity, he is referring to these three glands, may be regarded as organs at risk and need to be spared as much as possible during radiotherapy. Well, next is, now they are presenting some evidence suggesting it's just not these three glands. There is another gland macroscopically visible in the vicinity of the anterior opening of the Eustachian tube. Anterior opening of the Eustachian tube. Now, here are three photographs. You can see marked by the blue arrow is the area that is highlighted. It is in the posterolateral wall of the oropharynx. It is very much in the vicinity of the anterior opening of the Eustachian tube. Same thing, the second here also. This is a sagittal section and here is a horizontal. So in coronal, sagittal, parasagittal I would say, and horizontal section, they have shown areas of this gland being shown in higher contrast. That's very interesting. The visibility of anatomical features of the gland has also been confirmed by MRI. Okay, this is another thing that has added weightage to their observations on PTCT. Next, they have even identified the area clearly, demarcated the area, and in cadavers they have taken this tissue and they have done further investigations. You see, the needle is in the anterior opening of the Eustachian tube and the territory in its vicinity is the area they are describing as the salivary gland being present there. Of course, they have seen the mucous acini there, but hitherto we thought there is only a lymphatic aggregation, you know, we used to call it as tubal tonsil, etc. Now, besides that lymphatic part, there seems to be plenty of acini, predominantly mucous acini, seems to be there. Next, you see, they have taken histological sections. You can see the mucous nature of the acini, mucous acini. There's hardly any serous acini. Let's remember that, because there is something the authors is stressing at the end of this observation. And they have done that cytoplasmic PSMA expression. And they have noticed that these are the cells that show using this ligand. Now, this is an 3D reconstruction based on all these observations, and they have tried to reconstruct it. They are emphasizing that this is a submucosal in location. They are located in the ridge that surrounds the anterior opening, you know, that inverted hockey stick shaped appearance, that area. The dissected area, as they quote, from human cadaver showed a large aggregate of predominantly mucous gland tissue with multiple macroscopically visible duct openings in the dorsolateral pharyngeal wall. It's just not the acini, they have even been able to identify multiple ducts. It's not a single duct, it looks like there are many, many ducts. The gland was draped primarily over the torus tuberius, the anatomical structure formed by the cartilage that supports the entrance to the auditory tube. That's what I told you a little while back. That inverted hockey stick shaped area around the anterior opening of the Eustachian tube. The gland extended caudally to the pharyngeal wall and cranially up to the Rosen-Müller fossa. Next, there was no amylase expression in the gland, That means these cells are consistent with very little serous cell activity. That means there's hardly any serous acini. By and large, the author's opinion is this looks more like the sublingual salivary gland pattern. You see, more like sublingual salivary gland pattern when they look at the acini. Therefore, they are of the opinion that, well, here is a macroscopically visible group of glands fitting into the salivary gland classification. To our knowledge, this is the first description of paired macroscopic mucus, seromucus. You see, they just added the word sero, although it is mainly mucus. Mucus gland locations in the human postrolateral nasopharyngeal wall, and an indication of their clinical relevance in radiotherapy. Next, based on its predominant location over the torus tuberius, that is that anterior opening, we propose the name tuberial glands. Ultimately, they have, based on these reasonably strong evidences that they have presented, they propose to call this as tuberial glands. These glands were present as macroscopic structures identified by PSMA, that is prostate specific antigen, PET CT, in all the 100 individuals they have studied and into investigated cadavers. The occurrence of acinar cell groups in the nasopharynx is generally known. We know there is an admixture of both these glands, but they are spread in a pattern in a largely region, and we have not really made an effort to localize them and call it here it is there, here it is there. So as a result, a clearly defined clustered acini has just missed our eyes. Well, there could be many reasons why this happened and why suddenly a molecular technique has brought out something fantastic, a new concept. Poor accessibility of this location in routine imaging modalities. Okay, only by endoscopy you can see. That's an important point. The macroscopically visible excretory duct openings may have been, well, we may have just dismissed this as small pits, but has not been interpreted. That means we have not taken the trouble of looking at it in a larger context and trying to say, well, are there large enough acini to be called a distinct salivary gland possible. The discovery depended therefore on the introduction of a molecular imaging technique using radio labeled PSMA ligands. Next, probably having known that now as proposed, I'm sure in due course many more researchers are going to endorse the gland being present. Its function is speculated, and it's very easy to remember its function. Moistening and lubrication of the nasopharynx and the oropharynx is probably the best choice of a function we could consider. Well, is it a separate organ? Is it a major salivary gland? Is it a minor salivary? See, once there is proof that here is something very clearly structurally defined, these are the next few questions we may be interested as anatomists. Next, if it is an organ, does it fit into this definition? I'm not going into the details, but then these are the questions we need to be ready to answer. Now you see, there is pros and cons. If it is an organ, what are the strong points? If it is not an organ, what are the pros? Therefore, tuberial glands, there is no capsule, you see, remember that. But then the sublingual gland also had no capsule, and that was also a cluster of glands, mixed glands. So there are, you know, points against it, towards it, etc. But the point that the authors are emphasizing is the type and the frequency of the salivary gland tumors that occur in this area, that is the nasopharynx, and in the sublingual gland have an identical pattern. They have similar pattern. That's something very, very important. That adds to the proposal of the authors that this could be classified as, you know, a type of a sublingual type of a gland. Well, is it a fourth salivary gland? Now we need to have a discussion, a debate. Is this an organ or is it a minor salivary gland? If so, what type of, we need to look into the details of the classification. The question therefore that comes up here is it another or is it a fourth salivary gland? Very interesting, I would say. Now, the authors have been fair enough not only to propose but also give the points this side and that side. It also has certain similarities with the palatal glands. So we need to keep that also in mind before coming to a final opinion. Now, the final word the author seems to have mentioned, once again, excellent point for debate. All salivary glands could be interpreted as a continuum formed by smaller or larger collections of acini that together we should be calling it as salivary gland system. Remember, we have something like that for the lymphatics, the so-called Waldeyer's ring, things like that. Maybe is there a salivary acinar ring or something like that. Very interesting. Therefore, the end point of this discussion as per the authors are, tubarial glands are macroscopic glandular tissues located in a place where there is high clinical relevance. Therefore, at least whether they are organ, not all that controversy will be sorted out in due course. At least the authors feel, because of their location, the clinical relevance, etc., they at least need a name, a unique name of identification for daily clinical practice. Fantastic. This is very interesting. So these are the interesting points, my dear friends, I wanted to present in this journal club. Let's appreciate the authors for the keen sense of observation and their utilization of a newer molecular technique and integrating it into routine radiological imaging modalities. And there, right in front of our eyes, here is a new concept. Shall we therefore conclude that, as I started, anatomy doesn't change, but our understanding, our concepts of the human anatomy keeps changing, rather keeps growing. Thank you.